Greetings once again. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. This is sort of our 2.0 on the dialogue or battle between Nikola and Tesla regarding the specs on the semi-truck. So in my first round, I sort of did a cursory glance of all the statistics and thought I would do another round so we could sort of look more closely at what the numbers are. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Bonjour, wie geht's, Trasvice? Thanks for joining us once again. If you're new to our page, please like and subscribe. We have some great videos coming out, and we don't want you to miss anything. Today's talk focuses on kind of a battle between Nikola and Tesla. As you all know, until Tesla announced the truck, Nikola was sort of the king of the hill, at least in the United States, when it comes to long-range electric trucks. Nikola originally came out with a hybrid design where they were doing natural gas along with electric batteries, the 18650 batteries. They then pivoted away from that over a six-month period to do a hydrogen battery combination based on zero emissions. And so they've been working along that plan and have it listed that they're going to come out with a $375,000 truck 2019 or 2020. So what happened was when Tesla announced that, you know, the brand new truck, the folks at Nikola started sending out tweets initially, supposedly from staff, and then eventually from the CEO regarding the Tesla truck. And so one of the main headlines is Nikola says that Tesla / Elon Musk is full of it for several reasons. The first reason he articulated was that the battery packs are 144,000 by themselves. So the long-range truck is going for 180K. That's completely ridiculous because of what the cost of battery packs in the open market is right now. As we detailed, number one, Tesla is building its own gigafactory plant, and the 2170-based battery that Tesla is using, from our estimate, is about $10,000 per Model 3 pack. And they're actually using four packs in the semi that's long range, and three of them, I believe, in the short range semi. So what this means then is that Tesla's battery costs are theoretically, at least at the battery level, are in the 40K range. That says nothing about, you know, the rest of the cooling system or other parts. And so if we kind of rough guess the full costs, one could suggest then that it's about between $70,000 and $90,000 for the long-range truck that Tesla's building. The second piece of Nikola's argument was that it had to be under ideal conditions that was represented by the numbers they were presenting. I was kind of intrigued because there's a little bit of, in general, I think he's wrong, but there's a little bit of truth there because Tesla's really worked hard to identify ways to reduce drag in the form of a very efficient body on the truck, putting the driver in the middle, cleared up a lot of room to the left and right of the passenger cabin to modify the structure of the truck to make it more aerodynamic. So I think probably 20% or so, maybe a little bit less, of the savings that's experienced at the fuel level is associated with some of the aero things that Tesla's doing. They're not breaking it apart from what the battery's doing versus what the new body of the truck is offering. We also know that, you know, they're putting special skirts on the sides of the truck and top to make sure it seamlessly fits to the rear of the truck so that, you know, there aren't any gaps there that represent drag on the vehicle, and certainly that'll help as well. So The rest of the criticisms included, number one, it wasn't running on hills, etc. One of the big focuses of Nikola was the fact that they've been testing or prepared to offer a product particularly that focused on six motors in the wheels that permitted efficient climbing even on a 6-degree grade where the vehicle could do 60 plus miles an hour with ease. Tesla's electric product is comfortable with similar numbers. Elon Musk talked about using four motors instead of six, and it would run fine on just two motors, but there's a lot of interesting sort of new stuff that goes with those four wheels. I was intrigued because Elon Musk focused in his presentation on the whole idea of very high speed acceleration, which isn't a big deal for big trucks. But one of my trucker friends was pointing out that every day one of the biggest challenges for big trucks is people assuming that big trucks can stop as fast as cars can. And with the structure of how the electric motors in the wheels will work, it actually allows the stopping time for these large trucks to be a lot shorter, helping to eliminate a lot of jackknifing as well as accidents driven by, other types of drivers not recognizing how much room the trucks need to operate safely. The next thing that sort of comes to mind is that in the case of Nikola, the two biggest presentations for their value in the marketplace was, one, the fact that they could long range with electric / hybrid, and then two, when they did charge up, unlike the normal electrics, they were able to get it done in 15 minutes. With Tesla delivering a 30-minute recharge with their mega chargers, that whole 15-minute argument disappears. And as we covered earlier, the other problem is with the long-range situation, 500 miles a day prior to a charge covers about 80% of the market in the semi-zone. They don't have a sleeper cabin on this vehicle, so I don't think this is really designed to go after that side of the market, but that side of the market isn't sort of obviously the whole market. And there's plenty of time to come up with those new products later once you sort of mastered or knocked this out. The one last thing that popped up since we did our presentation is there's some video circulating around the web regarding a presentation that was done by the head of the truck division of Tesla. And he confirmed something that Elon Musk, as well as the CTO, mentioned, and that is that Tesla has achieved parity in many ways with a regular diesel truck. And one of the key areas is the amount of freight weight carried by the truck will be the equivalent of what a regular diesel truck hauls. So this is a really impressive, interesting development that the batteries... So one of the big holdups on going all electric in the batteries has been with the 18650, the amount of weight is so great that you wipe out most of the freight weight that the truck is allowed to carry. And now with Tesla achieving parity, you have a situation where they can carry the exact same amount of weight, which I believe is 33,000 pounds, as a regular semi, along with the weight of the truck and the engine. So this is really impressive, big news, and I think it really highlights the value proposition of the truck and the fact that there are going to be a huge number of people that are eager to get theirs and get them on the road and moving. Look forward to, well, there's more to cover on trucks, obviously. We'll be definitely there to cover it and introduce it in our dialogue. In our next episode, one of the things we'll be covering is the fact that what was also brought up is that it's unknown when the trucks would get to Europe, and that even though Norway, for example, where this announcement was made, is one of the biggest buyers of electric vehicles and plans to get rid of ICE engines by 2030. So we're looking forward to taking a look into what the order book looks like and why it is there'll be no trucks leaving the United States for a while out of the production coming from Tesla. In closing, I just was wanting to note that basically for Nikola, it's a nightmare scenario where they have a new competitor that's extremely good at what they do. They pretty much have wiped out Nikola in terms of what their value proposition is in the marketplace. And in fact, I think are a lower cost solution, because messing with hydrogen introduces all kinds of transportation and other challenges you don't have to deal with if you simply charge the truck up and drive it. So I could definitely see why Nikola is angry. I do believe they're going to have to pivot in order to stay in business. The interesting thing, though, is that they have a lot of options, and one of them that we didn't cover last time, I mean, obviously they could shut down or find a big partner as a couple of options, but they have another option, which is to simply remove the hydrogen engine and, you know, allow a shorter run off of an electric to be their market, because there's such a shortage of trucks that are on the electric side at every length of range that I think there's room for them to be successful. It's not the wide open, no competitors anywhere zone they had before, but there's plenty of room for them to make money and exist without, calling Tesla fraud or full of it, totally unnecessary, when you can just go into the marketplace and outperform and let that performance dictate what the conversation looks like. Please take time to like and subscribe. Would love to hear what your opinion is on the difference between Tesla and Nikola in this situation. I think that it's an important area of dialogue if you're interested in EVs, because of the amount of pollution. I want to say 70% of the freight is hauled by big trucks, and they represent a disproportionate amount of the pollution that comes from those diesel engines. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Tschüss, mach's gut, au revoir, les Hydro, Hoda Hafez.